Hey, what's up, everyone? This is a review a lot of people have wanted to see. It's the Android X360. It's another handheld from China. I think it's from China. It has two analog sticks, which are actually digital sticks, but they are mapped to different settings. So the D-pad is not mapped to the digital stick, as well as the ABXY buttons are not mapped to the second digital stick. It's a 5-inch. It's got, let's see here, I'm going to read this off of here for you. It says it's a 1.5 gigahertz, but like all the other devices, it's not. It's a 1 gigahertz with a 400 megahertz Mali GPU. It has an 800 by 400 high definition screen. It is a capacitive touch screen, and it is 5-point. I've already tested it. It's got HDMI out. It's a mirrored HDMI out, so there is no lag. And it supports M3D, which I don't really test ever, and 2160p video playback. It runs all the typical emulators. What's weird is usually these devices come with FPSE. This one actually comes with PSX for Droid, which I prefer. Oh yeah, and another thing I wanted to mention that I almost forgot was the accelerometer is really, really good on this. It's not backwards like it was on the Yenlips, and it's actually functions very well. Okay, let's take a look at the contents of the box. Here's a manual. Here's the device itself, but we'll get back to that in a second. Ignore this up here. That's for me taking off the screen and getting a whole bunch of gunk underneath it. It doesn't ship like that. Bottom of the box. It's got your charger, your HDMI to mini HDMI cable for TV out, and an OTG cable. Alright, let's start testing this thing out. The device is really well built, feels nice and sturdy, doesn't do click, you know, it doesn't click like the normal PMPs do. One thing I noticed is the controls are very, very, very stiff. Even the digital joysticks are very, very stiff. It's got a front-facing camera and a back-facing camera. I'm not really interested in that, so I'm not going to go into testing on that. Here's your volume up, volume down, your mini SD card. It does support 32 gig. I have one in there right now. This is your reset and upgrade button. You hold this to get into the recovery mode. This is your power. Here's your DC. Here's your on the go. It also charges. Your headphones, your HDMI, your microphone, and a hard reset button. Alright, here's your menu button here, your select and start, and your left and right buttons. This is a full D-pad. And that's about it. Let's boot it up. Okay, here it is. It ships with Ice Cream Sandwich by standard. It's pretty responsive. Well, the touchscreen is pretty responsive. There's a lag a little bit here and there. I guess you can call that the Android lag. The benchmarks aren't too impressive, but they're not bad either. They're good for classic gaming and for all your emulators. Nintendo 64 does play. It doesn't play with too many issues. It's pretty much the same as the YDPG18 and the YDPG16. Runs better than the S5110 though. The stock S5110, not the custom ROM. Here's the score I got on the Antutu benchmark. It was only a 2924, and Quadrant wasn't much better. Okay, this is Yupin N64 Plus. I'm going to map the controls so I can show you that they are different from the ABXY and the D-pad. So I'm going to go into input, map buttons for controller 1, and D-pad right is set to a number. Everything is set to a number, it seems. Here's my CPAD, I'm going to use that there. And here's the important part. Analog right, analog left, analog down, and analog up. If you notice, the number codes are 148, 146, and 152, and 150. The number codes on the D-pad are 22, 21, 20, and 19. So they are separate. Since they're digital, they really don't feel any different. Actually, the digital sticks feel a little bit more stiff, which is hard to believe because this D-pad is incredibly stiff. It does function, but there are a lot of problems with these controls. I took this apart, and the contacts for the buttons are really, really, really small. And the buttons are already sitting so low that they barely hit it when you touch it. So a lot of times you have problems when you're playing a game. You have to hit this really, really hard so it actually touches the contact. Same thing with the D-pad. If you're switching back really quick in between, sometimes it won't register, so it makes the game pretty much unplayable. This device was so close to being what everybody wanted, but they messed it up when it came to the controls. Everything was separate. Everything was set up right. I was so excited for it. And the controls, they just totally, totally suck. I don't know if this is because this is an early version. I don't think it can be fixed, though, because like I said, I took it apart and everything was built actually really nice inside, too. But when I took a look at the D-pad and everything, the way it was set up, the contacts were so tiny that these buttons can barely touch it. I even tried to take apart one of my Dingus and use the cushion pad, and that didn't help either. I tried doubling up the cushion pad, didn't help either. I tried cleaning the contacts on it, nothing. I'm going to show you guys some gameplay, let you see that it actually works. You know, the emulators run really well, but I'm going to show you some of the problems with the controls. You see, sometimes I have to press twice, and there's a little bit of lag on the control too, because I have to push it far. As you can see, hopefully you can see that, I'm pressing the buttons and it's not registering. It's pretty much unplayable. Pretty much all the games are like that. It's very few that run smoothly. I mean, control smoothly, sorry. And if I keep playing, I'm gonna get pissed off. So that's pretty much all I have for review. It does come with a full Google Play Market. There's only one application that didn't come up as compatible, and that was FPSE. Other than that, I do not recommend buying this.